Hello, how are you? How many of you have some major goals you'd like to achieve? Raise your hands, please. Very good. I know you do. That's why you showed up. I like to ask people whether or not they have goals that they'd like to achieve, and hopefully they're goals that really are worthy of your efforts and your talents. I want you to shake someone's hand right now on your right and left, look them in the eyes and say, you have something special. I like to ask whether or not you have goals, but I want to ask you another question. How many of you know that if you had your life to live over again, you could do more than what you've done thus far? Raise your hands, please. Now, that proves a point. But what we do and what we accomplish in life is only a tip of the iceberg of what's possible for us. So I want you to think about some goals that you'd like to achieve, and I'd like for you to, let's say, break them up in three categories. Number one, I want you to think about some personal goal you'd like to achieve. And I'd like for you to think about some career goal, some business goal that you'd like to achieve. And I want you to think about some social contribution, some impact you'd like to make with your life. It was Horace Mann who said, we should be ashamed to die until we've made some major contribution to humankind. I believe we live in the greatest country in the world that gives us an opportunity to leave our mark, to make a statement with our lives. And as you think about these goals, whatever those goals are, I want you to dramatically increase those goals. And I want to warn you, I don't want you to think about how you're going to do it. How is none of your business. The most important thing is just to increase those goals dramatically. I've found that most people fail in life, not because they aim too high and miss. Most people fail in life because they aim too low and hit. And many don't aim at all. So raise the bar on yourself. And don't ask how you're going to do it. I'll never forget when I decided that I wanted to become a motivational speaker. I saw the late Dr. Norman Vincent Peale, and my heart said, I can do that. But my mind asked the question, how? And for over 14 years, I would go see Zig Ziglar and Dr. Norman Vincent Peale and Jim Rohn and different speakers, and I would be in the audience, and my heart would pounce and say, you can do that, Les. And then when I would leave, I would be going to the parking lot, and my mind said, how are you going to do it? And I spent so many years trying to figure out how. I wasted 14 years. How many of you ever procrastinated? Raise your hands, please. Yeah, see, so as you begin to think about your goals, the most important thing is, and write this down, commit yourself. See, once you commit yourself, the how will come, the way will come. Once you commit yourself, you will then figure it out. If you're going in the wrong direction, all you have to do is turn around and go in the other direction. You will figure it out. You want to begin to just challenge yourself. You want to stretch yourself because you really don't know what you can't do. I want to challenge you right now about raising your goals, and I want you to shake someone's hand on your right and left, look them in the eyes and say, stretch yourself. See, I think that you really have to stretch yourself to discover your stuff. I think that we have to really begin to experiment with life. Not say that you have something special. I didn't say that just to be kind and courteous. You do. See, I think that there are not many people that come to the seminars and workshops or will watch a program of this nature. Why? I just think that most people are just satisfied to where they are. I'm reminded of a man one day, he was walking down the street, and he passed his porch where some people were on the porch talking, and there was a dog moaning and groaning. And he was curious why the dog was moaning and groaning, and he went back and he said, excuse me, he asked the owner, why is the dog moaning and groaning? The guy said, because he's laying on a nail. He said, well, why won't it get off? He said, it's not hurting bad enough for it to get off. Just hurting bad enough to moan and groan. How many of you know people who should be here? Raise your hands, please. How many of you know people all they do is moan and groan? Moan and groan. I'm not making enough money. Moan and groan. I'm unhappy with my job. 87% of people go to jobs that they hate. And in addition to that, you know, as we know that we have the dubious distinction in this country that on Monday morning, the heart attack rate increases over 35% on Monday morning between 6 o'clock and 9. People going to jobs that they hate. The heart said, didn't I tell you I didn't want to go, and attack them? Some of you don't want to go to work next Monday. So the thing is this. So you want to find out what resonates with you. What is it you really want to do? You want to experiment with life and find out what fits for you. You have something special. You have greatness within you. You have the ability to do more than you can ever begin to imagine. See, I believe that anybody through observation and practice can perform at the level of excellence. But when you're pursuing your greatness, this is worth writing down, you don't know what your limits are, and you act like you don't have any. So I say to you, you have something special. You have greatness within you. And I want to make four things clear. Number one, everything that I'm going to say, you already know it. If what I share, the message that I'm going to express right now and share with you, if it wasn't a part of who you are already, you wouldn't be in the audience. That's number one. That's very important. It's already in you. I'm going to only confirm and validate that which is a part of you anyhow. The second thing is, everything I'm going to say to you, you've heard it before from people with college degrees and credentials I can't hold a candle to. It's common sense, but not common practice. Third thing is, I don't want you to agree with me, and I don't want you to believe me. I just want you to be open to some things right now. I want you to think beyond that which is commonly allowed. I'm going to tell you what I'm up to. I want you to think about your goals, and I want to tell you what I'm going to do right now. My whole goal is to get past your mind. That's my whole challenge, and there's nothing you can do about it. I'm going to do that. So your assignment was to show up. My assignment is to get past your mind and get into your heart. Once you think about the goals that you want to achieve, and I really want to challenge you to make up your mind that you're going to make that happen for yourself. And I hope that it's some goal that really resonates with who you are. When I was a little boy, my goal was to just buy groceries for our family. My mother worked on Miami Beach. She was a domestic worker. And my goal was to really be able to go to the grocery store and purchase groceries ourselves. The families knew that my mother had adopted 7 children. And so they said, Mamie, whatever food is left over after we eat, you can take that home to the children. They were very kind, very, very considerate people. Who would have thought? I look at you, I say, you have greatness within you. You have the ability to do more than you can ever begin to imagine. No one could have convinced me that I would be doing what I'm doing right now. You know, the easiest thing I do every year is go into a sales organization and dramatically increase their sales, or go into a prison and enable prisoners to see themselves differently and teach them the methods and techniques of how to plug into the system, or motivate young people to begin to see how they can have a vision of themselves in the future and fit. That's the easiest thing I do, or train a speaker to help them to leverage their experience as a speaker and say, look, speaking is a projection of who you are, not who you think you ought to be, and come with power from a platform. That's the easiest thing I've ever done. Let me share with you the most difficult thing I've ever done. The most difficult thing I've ever done was to believe that I can do what I'm now doing. No one could have convinced me, just given my circumstances. I earn millions of dollars every year. No one could have convinced me. If both my parents came up here right now, I would not know either one. No one could have convinced me, being labeled educable, mentally retarded, born in an abandoned building on the floor in Liberty City, poor section of Miami, Florida, failing twice in school, no college training, never worked for a major corporation. I did not know I can do what I'm doing right now. Let us say together, as you think about your goals and your dream, let us say together, it's possible. Together, please. Say it like you mean it. Thank you. Write that down. See, most people never achieve their goals because most people suffer from possibility blindness. They look around trying to think about the things that they don't have. Robert Roots, a young man who wrote a book about success principles of the 3 little pigs. He said, it's not what you don't have, is what you think you need that keeps you from being successful or happy in life. It's not what you don't have. See, I was focused on what I didn't have. Don't have a college degree, don't have any credentials, never worked for a major corporation. I was focused on the negative things. It said, negative things are the things that you see when you're not focused on your goal. What do you come with? What is it that you have within you that you showed up to bring? Hey, Les, you don't know, but My dream is a long shot, long shot. So I say to you, see, I only attract millionaires or millionaires in training. Just gonna get that in a minute. You have something special. You have greatness within you. And the only reason you are here, you are my assignment. You can feel me. Some of you feel me right here in your heart of hearts. And my goal is to get past your mind and into your heart. So it's necessary that you have the mindset that I can do this. You've got to begin to believe and to fortify that belief and feed that belief by listening to tapes, going to seminars and workshops, by challenging yourself, by stretching yourself. It was Osborne who said, unless you attempt to do something beyond that which you've already mastered, you will never grow. And as you begin to challenge yourself, you'll discover some things about yourself that you don't know right now. The other thing is you begin to look at yourself, look at your dreams, and begin to experiment and stepping into your greatness. One of the things that's very important, whatever goals and dreams that you have, repeat after me, please. Make your move before you're ready. Price Pritchard, who's a great, great motivator and trainer, said, make your move before you're ready. We're instructed in life to walk by faith and not by sight. See, you want to really begin to stretch yourself. You want to become a risk taker. You want to raise the bar on yourself. Most people won't do that. See, most people engage in low life living, low risk living. Viscott said, if you're not willing to risk, you cannot grow. And if you cannot grow, you cannot become your best. And if you cannot become your best, you can't be happy. And if you can't be happy, then what else is there? I like what Helen Keller said. Life is short and unpredictable. Eat the dessert first. And so you want to begin to take some chances. You want to begin to challenge yourself and make it okay to fail and learn from your failures. Don't allow fear of failure and the allure, the attractiveness of playing it safe in life to draw you in. You can't get out of life alive. You got to die to leave here. Other thing is you look at yourself, look at your dreams, detoxify your life. Write that down. See, I think that most people never achieve their true goals in life because they're surrounded with too many toxic, negative, energy-draining people. You've got to look at the people in your life and ask yourself the question, what is this relationship doing to me? How is it impacting my life? Am I a better person? Sidney Poitier wrote a book called The Measure of a Man. And it's powerful, but I encourage you to get the tapes. I love his voice. And he said something in there. He said, when you go for a walk with someone, something happens unconsciously. It's not spoken. Either you adjust to their pace or they adjust to your pace. Whose pace have you adjusted to? See, you want to surround yourself. My daughter, Ona Brown, who's a speaker and coach, she says, call forth your team, but make sure these are people that you can learn from. I never forget, I'm on a special board with a Bishop T.D. Jakes, and we went into a board meeting. He looked at everybody before opening the meeting. He said, as soon as I know as much as you do, you're fired. And with that, the meeting is now open. Everybody continued to learn on that board. Trust me, that a friend of mine, Dennis Kimbrough, motivational speaker out of Atlanta, he said, if you're the smartest one in your group, you need to get a new group. So as you look at yourself and look into the future, call forth your team. George Frazier says, your network determines your net worth. Who do you allow to be in your ear? What kind of relationships are you developing? Are they an asset to you or they are a liability? Do they elevate your spirits or do they tear you down? You get two types of people, nourishing people and toxic people. Nourishing people, they bring the best out of you. They encourage you, they inspire you, they hold you accountable. Toxic people, they are critical people, always telling you what you can't do. They're always measuring your possibilities based upon their failures. My mother said, never let anybody tell you what you can't do, son, especially if they haven't done it. They don't know what's possible for you. So as you begin to look at yourself, begin to identify the relationships that you communicate with most and say, hey, is this relationship helpful to me? And then think about some people that you need to bring into your life that you can learn from, that you can grow from. I joined the National Speakers Association when I decided that I wanted to speak. I wanted to be around the people that were doing what I wanted to do. I'll never forget when I saw Dr. Norman Vincent Peale. He said, you have something special. You have greatness within you. And you can do more than you can ever begin to imagine. And here I am. And the audience said, oh my goodness. I'd read The Power of Positive Thinking 17 times, my hero. And I saw him backstage, and I said, Dr. Peel, hi, my name is Les Brown. I've listened to your tapes and I've read your books. They gave them to us in special education, sir. And one day I would love to be on stage with you. And he looked at me and said, it's possible, young man. It's possible. But this man, when he spoke, he gave me goose pimples. Deep baritone voice, dope spoke from his diaphragm. You have something special. You have greatness within you. He override the inner conversations in my mind. I'll never forget a gentleman, what a brilliant man, a Harvard graduate. Dr. Carter G. Woodson, he said, if you can determine what a man shall think, you never have to concern yourself with what he will do. If you can make a man feel inferior, you never have to compel him to seek an inferior status, for he will seek it himself. And if you can make a man feel justly an outcast, never have to order him to go to the back door. He'll go without being told. And if there's no door, his very nature will demand one. See, we live in a world where we're told more about our limitations rather than our potential. How many of you have been told that you couldn't do something? Raise your hands, please. You know, MIT did a study that if I say to you, you can't do that, that 16 people have to come along and say, you can do that, you can do that, you can do that, to neutralize that. And the 17th statement that you hear, you can do it, will be the one that will finally stick. So you have to watch who's speaking it to you. You've got to begin to monitor your mind. And you've got to begin to literally be proactive in programming yourself to success. Be not conformed to this world. Be it transformed by the renewing of your mind. You've got to take responsibility to make that happen. And as you begin to do that, you'll begin to see some incredible changes in your life. I understand now when Earl Nightingale said, all of us are self-made, but only the successful will admit it. As you begin to look at your dreams and look at your goals, write this down. Make know your vitamin. See, most people stop short of their dreams and park and get off the highway of life because of the rejections of life. You will always be rejected. It's no big deal. Jack Canfield said rejection is a myth. It's not like when somebody says no and then they slap you. No, it's just, you know, to me, make no your vitamin. Get excited about the no. Why? Because every time someone says no, that brings you another step to a yes. You're getting closer. Trust me, you will win if you don't quit. You will win if you don't quit. Even a broke clock is right twice a day. The other thing is, as you look at yourself and look at your goals and look at your dreams, assess yourself. What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? What do you bring to the table? When I looked at becoming a motivational speaker, I looked at all the speakers and I noticed that they were pretty much scripted. So I said, what is it that can make me stand out? I don't have any college education. I don't have any credentials. I never worked for a major corporation. What is it I can do to offset my weaknesses? And then somebody said, well, Les, and this is very important, Mr. Washington, Mr. Brown, yes, sir, what do you want to do with your life? I want to become successful. Good. He said, you must be willing to do the things today others won't do in order to have the things tomorrow others won't have. That's why you said you have something special. See, very few people go to seminars and workshops. They'll go to a concert, but showing up to get something that can expand their minds and help them to begin to see their lives differently, to give them a larger vision of themselves, they'll be too busy. Or they say, well, how much does it cost? Well, information costs, but it pays for itself. Here's the other thing is, ladies and gentlemen, let's say it's me. Yeah, see, it's possible you can live your dream. It's necessary that you have the mindset that I'm going to do this. But you've got to take ownership. You've got to decide, hey, I'm going to do this. You've got to take responsibility for your life. George Bernard Shaw said, the people that make it in this life, they look around for the circumstances that they want, and if they can't find them, they create them. You've got to decide, it's me. You've got to say, and say this with conviction, I expect to win. Yes, I think it's important that we say that. You know, if you ask most people, do you want to become successful? They will say yes. You got to kick it up a notch, son. You never thought you'd be in your 30s. You got to kick it up a notch. You got to increase your energy in order to live your dreams. You can't be casual about your dreams. Bill Bailey said, if you're casual about your dream, you'll end up a casualty. Check someone's hand on your right and left and say, kick it up a notch. Yes. Yes. You got to kick it up a notch. What is it you bring? And whatever you bring, you've got to kick it up a notch. What is your signature as you look at where you want to go and what it is you want to do? As you look at your product or your services, repeat after me, please, provide more service than you get paid for. Yeah, see, that becomes your signature. When you look at your goals and look at where you want to go, at your products, at your services, at your industry, you want to set some high standards for yourself. I like what Henry David Thoreau said, do not go where the path may lead, but go where there's no path and leave a trail. How is it that your industry will be done differently 5 years from now, 10 years from now? What is your reputation in your industry? When you come into a room and you leave, what's the scuttlebutt about you? Do people say, hey, that's a go-to person. That's a person, if you ask them to do that job, you're talking about the job being done. It will be done extremely well. Are you known for that person that stand out with what you do, that stand out with your quality of service, with your standards, always looking for ways to better your best? Are you one of those people that believe, well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it? Japanese believe it ain't perfect, keep working on it. Are you willing to keep working on it? Are you willing to realize that you have not done your best stuff yet, that you can better your best? You got to take responsibility for that. Now let's go to the next level. Not only is it possible that you can live your dream, is it necessary that you call forth your team and surround yourself with people that you can learn from and grow from, that you must work on yourself and monitor yourself and train yourself, that you've got to begin to take total responsibility for the outcomes that you want to produce in your life. See, life is hard, and there are some moments in life when you're going to need some help. You're going to need somebody to speak to you. You're going to need somebody to say something to you. I have a friend of mine, Willie Jolly, who's a motivational speaker. He said, a setback is a setup for a comeback. I had to listen to Willie's tapes. I have another friend, Kevin Bracey, who's a speaker. He said, Les, come on, man, you can do this. You can make this happen. You can hit a home run. It's a done deal. You are Les Brown. That cancer's got to get out of your body. I said, talk to me, Kevin. Talk to me. That's what I need to hear. I needed to hear those words. I don't care who you are. Many people won't allow themselves to ask for help because of pride. Pride cometh before a fall. Because of ego. Ego means edging God out. No, ask for help. Not because you're weak, but because you want to remain strong. And ask for help and don't stop until you get it. I'm here because a lot of people helped me. I'm here because a lot of people believed in me at a time when I was struggling to believe in myself. The other thing is, let us say together, it's worth it. Yeah, see, I think, and write this down, you got to find five reasons that will make it worth it for you. Five reasons. What will make it worth it for you? Mine was, I want to take care of my mother. Mine was, I want to do something with my life. What will make it worth it for you? Mine is, I want to leave a legacy. Mine is, I refuse to die an unlived life. What will make it worth it for you? Repeat after me, please. You got to be hungry. You got to be hungry. He said, I want you to listen to Paul Harvey. He's the world's greatest communicator. Always find a coach or mentor, someone that's doing what it is you want to do. Watch them. Listen to how he does the rest of the story. Listen to his voice. Mr. Brown, develop your mind and develop your communication skills, because once you open your mouth, young man, you tell the world who you are. And don't forget, Mr. Brown, you got to be hungry. Take the time to develop yourself. So I start training and working on myself. People that want to step into their greatness are hungry. Shake someone's hand on your right and left and say, you gotta be hungry. What is your legacy? What will your statement be? Resolve every day. Read it every day. I refuse to die an unlived life. I like to leave this with you that Mama used to love to hear me say. She'd say, boy, say that thing for me, and I dedicate this to you, to the greatness that's within you, because it's there. And it says simply this: if you want a thing bad enough to go out and fight for it, to work day and night for it, to give up your time, your peace, and sleep for it, if all that you dream and scheme is about it, and life seems useless and worthless without it, and if you gladly sweat for it and fret for it and plan for it, and lose all your terror of the opposition for it, and if you simply go after that thing that you want with all of your capacity, strength and sagacity, faith, hope, and confidence, and stern pertinacity, if neither cold, poverty, famine, shall go, sickness or pain of body and brain can keep you away from the thing that you want, if dogged and grim you besiege and beset it, with the help of God you'll get it. This has been Mrs. Mamie Brown's baby boy. God bless you and God bless America. You have greatness in you.